talking about work that's in its early stages that's focused on how gene by environment interactions drive developmental responses to microbiota disturbance in three-spine stickleback. So we're learning more and more that gut microbes seem to have a huge influence on post-development. And so some of these examples include the stimulation of development of certain tissues and cell types, particularly those involved in the digestive system, the recruitment of innate immune cells, including neutrophils, which you can see here. And in some cases, microbiota diversity is also associated with different behavioral syndromes. And we also see in surveys across taxa that there's a huge amount of variation in gut microbial diversity. So in this example here, this is a survey of human populations. Each vertical line represents a different individual color-coded by the dominant bacterial taxa that are present. And what we're seeing is that this diversity is controlled both by host genetic background as well as environmental variables such as diet. And so our main question concerns how disruptions to the gut microbiota influence physiological and behavioral development, and whether we see gene by environment interactions in the magnitude and direction of developmental responses. And to address this question, we're using the three-spine stickleback system. So in some of our experiments, we are comparing germ-free versus conventionally reared individuals, and these are fish that are raised in diverse microbial environments. And we're also doing experiments in which we treat individuals with antibiotics to change the microbial communities in their environment. And so we all know at this point that stickleback are great model organisms for studying evolution. You've heard that quite a bit since you've been here. But we're also arguing that stickleback are great model organisms for understanding host-microbe interactions. So we can capitalize on the natural genetic and environmental variation that's seen in wild populations, and the fact that we can study these natural replicates and easily sample both their internal and external microbial communities using advanced genetic techniques. Another advantage of using stickleback is that they share extensive physiological and immunological features with all vertebrates, including humans. So what we ascertain from these stickleback studies can be really readily applied to understanding other taxa as well. We can very easily bring stickleback into the lab, where we can capitalize on our ability, or on the stickleback's optical transparency as juveniles, so that we can non-destructively measure their morphology, their small size and their rapid development, as well as large sample sizes. We can rear them in really large numbers in the lab quite cheaply and easily, so that we can develop these statistically robust studies in which we can experimentally manipulate the microbes, the host, and or the environment. And so for all of these reasons, we're really able to investigate the influence of gene by environment interactions on host microbe symbioses. So these are some of the tools that we have at our disposal. We can do neutrophil staining to quantify differences in immune response in individuals for these different treatments. We can use both plating and DNA techniques to characterize microbial communities that are present in both the environment and the fish. We can also do RNA and DNA sequencing to measure variation among individual hosts. And we can take advantage of the really rich history of study in stickleback to measure quite a few of their morphological features and also get into in-depth analyses of their behavior. So getting back to our questions, the first type of experiment I'll talk about compares our germ-free versus conventionally reared individual. This is obviously the extreme end of microbial disruption. So the populations that we use in the experiment are lab lines from the University of Oregon, and Mark Curry was kind enough to give us crosses from both Blue Plate. This is our freshwater population, and Rabbit Slough, our oceanic population, that are originally from South Central Alaska, and these populations are both very well studied. We know that they're genetically and phenotypically distinct. And in order to make the fish germ-free, since they develop externally, we can very simply surface sterilize the eggs with iodine and bleach. And we run these experiments for 14 days, at which point we videotape the fish for their exploratory behavior. And then we also, we euthanize them and take photos, seen here, that we can use to measure various aspects of their morphology. So what we see is that conventionally reared oceanic fish have larger swim bladders and are longer than germ-free fish. And this is not true for our freshwater individuals. We didn't see any differences in morphology with the freshwater population. When we looked at exploratory behavior, the initial assays that we're doing, this is what our tissue culture flask looks like, and each one of these red circles represents an individual fry. So these guys are pretty tiny on day 14. We videotape them on this grid for 5 minutes, and we quantify the total number of squares that each fish enters, the number of unique squares that a fish enters, and this would distinguish between a fish that just goes paces back and forth between two squares versus one that traverses all around the tank, and also the number of perimeter squares that a fish enters. And so this would distinguish between a shyer fish that would spend more time on the perimeter of the flask versus a bolder fish that would enter the center of the flask. And we used a principal components analysis to analyze these data. And we see here that principal component one accounts for about 80% of our total variation. And this represents a continuum in our oceanic fish between conventionally reared versus germ-free treatments. So we see that oceanic, germ-free, and conventionally reared fish significantly differ in their PC1 scores. And this is driven by differences in perimeter squares. So we see that germ-free fish tend to spend more time on the perimeter and conventionally reared fish. When we look at our freshwater treatments, we see that PC2, which represents about 15% of the overall variation, separates our conventional and our germ-free fish. And in this population, we see that conventionally reared fish travel a greater distance, but that germ-free fish, again, similar to our oceanic population, spend more time on the perimeter, but they also enter more unique squares than the conventionally reared individuals. So what we can conclude so far from these experiments is that the oceanic germ-free fish appear to be smaller than those raised conventionally and have smaller swim bladders, whereas we so far see no differences in morphology in the freshwater fish. And in terms of behavior, both oceanic and freshwater germ-free fish spend more time in the perimeter, and also our freshwater germ-free fish enter more unique squares than the conventional. So the second experiments we're running involve exposing stickleback to antibiotics early in development. And ultimately, we hope to mimic two very different scenarios. So the first would be to mimic these low levels of antibiotics that fish and waterways are exposed to. So we know more and more that antibiotics are polluting basically every waterway in the United States and Europe, all over the industrialized world. But we really don't know the chronic exposure to these low levels, how they're affecting the fish, particularly their fitness. So this is work that's funded by my NSF postdoc. And then we are also hoping to mimic this scenario in which children are exposed short-term to clinically relevant levels of antibiotics. And this is work that is being led by our master's student, Ryan Lucas, and it's funded by the Alaska Inbreed. So for our preliminary experiment that we ran last summer, we used three populations, again, from South Central Alaska. We have two freshwater populations from Big Lake and Westchester Lagoon, as well as an oceanic population from Mud Lake. And helping us with our field collections and crosses was Tom Nelson from the University of Oregon. Thank you, Tom. And so we did our crosses in the lab, and just like our germ-free experiment, reared our fish in tissue culture flasks. And this is what our experimental setup looked like. So we had four treatments. We had a control in which individuals were reared in just conventional water. We had both low and high tetracycline treatments, and also an ethanol treatment, which served as a control for the ethanol that was used to resuspend the tetracycline in our treatment conditions. And each one of those was done in triplicate. So again, these experiments went until 14 days post-fertilization. The antibiotics were added on day 12. And at the end of the experiment, we measured exploratory behavior, morphology. We dissected out the guts to quantify the gut microbial community diversity and membership. And then we preserved the bodies in RNA later for immune gene expression analysis. So we see that antibiotic-treated fish have increased eye diameter in our Big Lake freshwater population. And this is also true for our Westchester freshwater population. But interestingly, we see no difference in eye diameter in our Mud Lake oceanic population. When we look at standard length, we see that high antibiotic treatment decreases standard length in our Big Lake freshwater population and actually has the opposite effect in our Westchester freshwater population. And then again, we see no difference in morphology in our Mud Lake population. And lastly, we see that high antibiotic treatment decreases swim bladder area only in our Westchester freshwater population. And so far, our behavioral results are not demonstrating any significant differences in any of our three populations. And helping us with this work is undergrad Haley Miller. So what we conclude so far is that gene-by-environment interactions appear to drive responses to antibiotic exposure, with our freshwater populations demonstrating increased developmental instability as compared to our oceanic population. So in progress is our 16S microbial community profiling, in which we hope to accomplish two goals. So one would be to survey the natural variation that's found in microbial communities from these three populations, and then secondarily, to see if exposure to antibiotics is eliciting the same changes to microbial community diversity and composition in these three populations. Also in progress is qPCR analysis of immune genes, and this work is being led by our undergrad, Kelly Ireland. And ultimately, what I hope to gain from this line of work is to understand whether we can recover normal phenotypic development if we transfer fish to conventional environments after they're exposed to either germ-free rearing or antibiotics early in development. I hope to identify the critical windows in development in which disruption to the microbiome results in physiological or behavioral changes, and then ultimately determine whether fitness is affected. So with that, I'd like to acknowledge everyone who's helped out on this project, as well as our funding sources. And if you'd like to know more, I would encourage you to check out our undergrad, Penny Sparks. He has a poster tonight that is on in vitro work that he's doing, exposing different bacterial isolates to antibiotics. And with that, I would be happy to take any questions. So the question was whether we are potentially going to look at how this influences susceptibility to Schistosephalus, which is a very common stickleback parasite. We have thought about that because most of the populations that we are surveying have really, really high rates of infection by these worms. So yeah, that's something that we could definitely look at.
Thank you.